Okay.
No, just saying, this is for that, some, is it, it's my crew, for some people to, like, run back in the door, or, you know.
Very good question. Very good question. How would you describe now? Let's see. This carrying of the Quran in the hands is halal or haram? Ye baat mein alag kar lena. Is it haram? Is it halal? Halal is mubah, or it is makruh, or it is mustahab? Where does it fall?
Without the wudu.
Without the wudu. Makruh. Who agrees with her? Okay, that means even if you read with this, if it is makruh, will you be punished with? If you no, very good. Okay, your answer is correct. But it is not requirement. It is not requirement. Some people, they do quote this, they read from Surah Al-Waqi'ah, La yamassuhu illa al-mutahharun. La yamassuhu illa al-mutahharun. This ayah in the Quran, Allah says that nobody touches the Quran except those who are pure. Okay, now, pure means what? One tafsir is pure, you should be spiritually pure. Your soul should be pure, which means you're Muslim. Okay? Because Allah says that spiritually the non-Muslims are impure because they are spiritually impure. Not like they have got dirt in them or filth in them. No. Spiritually, because the faith is not there. So faith means this is, the purity means, mutaharun means with the iman. This is one answer. And if we take it even physical, okay, physical, like we are all humans, we hold the Quran in our hands. So this is the touching of the Quran physically. So does that mean in this ayah that physically we cannot touch the Quran without purity? Then you will learn, now next time inshallah, you have the notes already, you have, what is purity? Okay, physical purity. There is spiritual, as we have discussed, it is iman and kufr. But physical purity is what? Physical purity is that if you are unclean, if you don't, you know, like you don't have wudu, or if you are in your period, or you have got any other thing. So if that physical thing is there, then is it really required for you to touch the Quran, to, you know, have a pure, physically pure, to touch the Quran? And does that mean ghusl? Does that mean wudu? Or does that mean just your hand should be clean? The last one is the answer. That your body, your hands, your place where you place the Quran should be clean. And what does that ayah tells us? To understand that ayah, you will learn in the tafsir, inshallah, I will teach you. There's also the principle of tafsir. To understand that particular ayah, where Allah says, nobody touches it except those who are clean and pure, that to understand that particular text of the ayah, you have to read something before those, this verse, something below this verse. Then you will know the complete scenario, that what Allah is talking about, which kind of Quran is Allah is talking about, which physical purity or spiritual purity Allah is talking about. And if you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the Quran, which is in the Lawhul Mahfuz. Why? Why? It can be this Quran. I can prove it. No, it is not this Quran. No. Brother Abdul Muttalib say, no, it is this Quran. I will say, no, it is not this Quran. And I will say, it is the Quran which is in the, you know, with Allah in the Lawhul Mahfuz. When only angels are touching. That Quran is only touched by the angels. Nobody else. What is the dalil? The Quran. As I said, if you read the 2-3 verses above and 2-3 verses below, you will see the whole thing Allah speaks about the angels protecting the Quran And that Quran Allah is saying in one of these verses, Allah is saying, لَا يَمَسُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَهَرُونَ. That Quran, which is protected by angels, that Quran is not touched by anybody except those who are
pure.
So it refers to the Quran, that Quran, and the touching people are angels. Make sense? This is one dalil from the Quran. Another logic dalil, I can prove it is not this Quran. And I'm helping you because sometimes you have to open your brain, okay? You don't have to follow the Maulvis and just hold their the tail and walk behind them, no. This Quran was not existing in the book form during the time of Rasulullah. So this cannot be this one. Because this, the book shape came only after the death of Rasulullah, death of Umar, and death of Abu Bakr. It came actually in a book form, in this shape, it came at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu. So we can't say that Allah is referring to this Quran. Make sense? You will agree with me or just say because I'm saying this, you're saying yes,
makes sense.
Scrolls.
Yeah, but the scroll is not, you can't name all of it as Quran. Okay, like you Surah Al-Fatiha, you can say generally it is part of the Quran, but Surah Al-Fatiha is not the whole Quran. But Allah is saying, لَا يَمَسُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَهَرُونَ. Nobody touches it. Again, the word Quran is not there. You have to understand that Allah speaks about the Quran, you have to go back to the first verses, few verses above and few verses below. This is how you learn your Quran. It's not just, you know, picking and choosing one ayah and emphasizing and giving the meaning. No, it has to be understood that way. So let's come to this part. And the answer to this question is, touching of the Quran does not require wudu as an obligatory issue. It is permissible, and some of the scholars, they say it is disliked. But even if it is permissible or even it is disliked, it's not blameworthy because there is no punishment for that. So we have to keep our mind open. Okay? Otherwise, just take an example. We are reading this Quran for maybe 5 minutes, 10 minutes, we'll conclude the class. But what happens? Those children and those girls and boys who are going for hifz classes, they can't maintain the wudu for 1 hour, 2 hours like that. Definitely they will have to, and some people are aged people, elderly people, they can't hold the wudu for a long time. And they have some, you know, scientific problems in their stomach. And they break their wudu. Does that mean that they have to go again to do the wudu and then come back? By the time the imam must have finished, mashallah, everything what he wants to. Yeah. And the third dalil for this Quran. Yusuf, third dalil. First dalil is that Allah speaks about that Quran. And Allah speaks about the angels. From the Quran I have proven. Second, I have proved that this Quran was not existing when this ayah revealed. When Allah revealed that ayah, this Quran was not in this shape. The third dalil is that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our teacher, yes? And he told us that Allah will not accept your prayers without the wudu. Allah will not accept your salah, your namaz without the wudu. But where did Allah say that Allah will not accept your reading of the Quran without the wudu? Nowhere. Did Allah say that? Did Rasulullah say in the hadith? No. So, wudu is required where? For the salah. Who said that? Rasulullah. So, we take that wudu for that purpose. And if we do any other activities of ibadah, wudu is not required because the one who taught Islam, he didn't tell us to have wudu for other things. Make sense? Okay, so this is the, you know, mind opening. Let's read now. To start the Quran anytime, you should always say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem. That's the usul. Okay, first usul is that whenever you start the Quran, you should say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem. And the second thing is that with regards to Bismillah, Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Bismillah is only needed when you start the surah from the beginning. But A'udhu is required all the time. whenever you start the Quran, anytime, you have to read Isti'adha, which is A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem. But Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is only when you start the surah at the beginning, from the beginning. Not like sometimes you are reading, you know, Ayatul Kursi. So you can just start A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum. So you don't have to say Bismillah after A'udhu, because Ayatul Kursi is in the middle of the surah. It's not at the beginning of the surah. But whenever you read the surah at the beginning, then you have to start with Bismillah as well. Make sense? Clear? It will remain in your head? Okay, alhamdulillah, let's start. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. All of you, please. And copy me. I want you to have a rhythm like that. And when inshallah we'll have an event for the any Islamic event, I will pull one of you to read. I did with my daughter, mashallah, Fatima. We had one event here in Venue Center. And my daughter, mashallah, she read 20 verses of Surah Taha. And it was mesmerizing the people. And the Arab families, they came. Sheikh, is this your daughter? I said, yes, my daughter, but she is beautiful. In her character, myself. She, the style is mine, but the voice is hers, mashallah. Alhamdulillah. Okay, let's read. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Same, not like that. Yes. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين. الرحمن الرحيم
الرحمن الرحيم
مالك يوم الدين
مالك يوم الدين
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين
إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم
اهدنا الصراط
صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين I will teach you afterwards, inshallah. We will do this class next week as well, also the Fatiha. But meantime, you can follow the translation. This is the theme of the whole surah is mentioned over here. Supplication to Allah for guidance taught by Allah Himself. So the whole surah, what's the concept of surah to Fatiha, Yusuf? It's a dua that you do to Allah. And what dua you are asking? Women will say, if they are not married, Allah, get me husband. A man will say, if he is not married, get me wife. No, that's not the dua. The best dua is guidance to the right path. This is the guidance. So whenever you ask Allah, first ask the best and then put your issues. No problem. Allah is full of generosity, so He'll give you everything. But first ask the main. Because Allah has given the whole world to the kuffar. But what is the benefit of that if they don't have iman? So ask Iman first and then you ask your subject. So the theme of Surah Al-Fatiha is what? That is the prayer between you and Allah. So you ask Allah and you are asking the best dua to Allah, that Allah give me the straight path. That inshallah will continue next week, inshallah. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. So next time bring the Quran with you, inshallah. And bring all the questions if you have. Or you can email me, it will be confidential. You have my emails. It will be confidential. If you have got any questions, I will, without mentioning your name, I will discuss the question here. And even if you have got some personal things, that also you can discuss with me on email and I will answer them.